The answer is no, Stanley.
But Mom, all the guys are going to Cartman's grandma's for the weekend.
I'm sorry, Stanley. I can't let you go all the way to Nebraska by yourself. It's the holidays.
But all the other guys get to go to Cartman's grandma's. Why can't I?
I'll leave it up to your father.
Well, that's fine with me.
The answer is no, Stanley. Now go wash up for supper.
Slipping through the streets of New York every night, wrapping bad guys up in my web so tight, crawling up the walls, making villains fight. What fun to make the holidays free from crime tonight. Oh, spider bells, goblin spells, vulture laid an egg. Spider buggy blew a tire and venom got away. Hey, spotty bells, swinging all the way. Oh, what fun it is to fight the bad guys every night.
Normally during the Christmas season, we start the program by showing an outside shot of our all-American Christmas tree on Fox Square. But last night, shortly after midnight, somebody climbed up in the tree and lit it on fire. It's beginning to look a lot like arson. Right now there is somebody who is in custody and is being interviewed by local police.
Who sets a Christmas tree on fire?
Who sets a Christmas
tree? Well, I mean, it's just part of the rampant. No city is safe. No person is safe from the subway on down.
Say, Santa, what have we here?
These are new dolls. Now, this little doll walks, talks, cries, and she even sings.
Almost like a real, live little girl.
That she is, sir. That she is. All she needs is tender, loving care.
Gilmar, what is a doll? I don't know, Gilmar. What is tender, loving care?
I don't know either.
Beaumont, Gemma, I told you not to watch those silly Earth programs. Now go to sleep.
Must we go to sleep now, Father? I want to see Santa Claus some more. I want to see more toys.
No, go to sleep.
So it's still really raining hard, too, right?
It's not raining at the moment.
It's not, okay.
At the moment. Ah. Well, and I had my vehicle outside. I moved it inside a little bit ago. Yeah.
Well, not to flex, but I think it was almost 50 today in the city. And calm. No tornadoes, no earthquakes, nothing.
Well, it wasn't cold. I mean, you know how it is with tornadoes.
Right. It needs to be pretty warm, right?
Yeah.
For it to develop.
Mm-hmm. It was 70-ish this last weekend. Very nice.
Yeah, here too. Saturday, it was in the 60s. I don't think we hit 70, but it was in the 60s. It was very nice.
Got a little work done outside, took a nap, felt like napping, so I did.
And you should, that's the right time to nap.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Not when they tell you to nap, not when the whole class has to nap, but when you want to.
That's right, they say they're healthy. Mm-hmm. Boom. God.
Do you...
I should take my computer to the door and just open it so y'all could hear the wind.
Let's
or the tree. You know how much work that would be?
Oh, you're just going to tease us with it. Just tantalize us. Mm-hmm. Everybody's waiting to hear now. Maybe you could just go like, or something. Pretend. So the theater of the mind.
If this were a visual thing, to see the trees. Mm. That's a little scary. All these trees with these beautiful decorations are just getting the heck and butt kicked out of them. Things that's holiday time, Christmas time, Hanukkah time, festive time.
Holidays. You know, I gotta say, New York City, especially Times Square area, right, just looks wonderful at Christmas.
They do it upright.
Well, it's all the stores, of course, have the lights and everything, but it's just, you know, it's all the people on the streets. It looks like on TV, or like, you know, the TV shows that.
Happiness and joy and kindness, even in New York City.
Well, I'm not going that far. I'm just saying the way it looks, the aesthetic, not necessarily.
They show it on TV.
Yeah, it just looks like television. You know, it looks like. And I go through. I went through Times Square. Actually, I had to walk through Times Square tonight because I went to this place I go to called Book Off, where I get cheap. It's like three stories. The main floor is Blu-rays, DVDs, action figures, video games.
I think you've told us about this.
I think so. Yeah, it's a great place. But I swung by there. I haven't been there in a while. I swung by there and got like $20 worth of cheap videos, $3.99 a piece. I got they have a bargain section, right, which is where they put stuff after it's been sitting on the shelf. The turnover there is incredible. They've got so much stuff coming in, right, because they buy stuff from people. So to get rid of it, they try to move it through fast. And so if it sits on the shelf for, I think, like 90 days, according to the price sticker, they'll move it to the bargain section, right? So, which is $3.99, which is a pretty good price point for a Blu-ray.
Shoot, that's right. Probably get shot first.
Yeah, yeah. And things occasionally sneak through, like they misprice them or whatever. They look them up and can't find them or whatever. But, I got both Incredibles movies, the Pixar movies.
Aww.
The second one's actually 4K, which is pretty incredible as well.
Oh, get it, pretty incredible. That, you're just throwing them down today, aren't you?
It's a pun. I got Arrow, you know that series, the TV series Arrow? The Green Arrow comic book guy, you know, the archer. Kind of shoots the arrows.
Okay. I could kind of glean that when you called him.
Yeah, okay. I got season two of that, again, for $3.99. I think it's like six discs. Yeah, I got District 9, which is a great movie from a few years back. A science fiction movie from New Zealand director. Anyway, my point is,
went through Times Square.
I went through Times Square, and it is it's packed with people, which is a little bit annoying, I walk through Broadway, Broadway, and people are lining up to go in and getting their vaccines checked, and it feels festive. It just really feels, you know, it doesn't feel like the obviously I grew up in a smaller town in Nebraska, so it doesn't feel like my childhood, but it kind of feels like the childhood, you know, I had by proxy, like if you've seen Miracle on 34th Street, right?
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. You got Macy's and some of that stuff looks kind of the same still.
Oh.
Yeah. No, it's just, yeah.
That'd be fun. You can imagine how much fun it is for people who have been wanting to visit New York and perhaps for the first time in the holidays.
Mm-hmm.
What a beautiful time.
Uh-huh.
And now they get to be there.
Right. Oh, you got the big Christmas tree too, right? The Rockefeller Center.
Yeah, and I hate that.
Yeah. See, I walked.
The reason I hate it is I think about this poor tree
that's
been alive and loving life. And then all of a sudden somebody comes home and goes, yeah, you get to be the Christmas tree. And the tree's like, no, I just want to be a big tree. I'm happy where I am, doing what I'm doing. Just let me keep growing, man. And they're like, no, you get to be a big Christmas tree. And the tree says, I don't want to. They say, we don't care.
But it gets to see New York, at least.
Trees don't care.
Not all trees get to do that, you know? You don't know, trees growing up on a farm, on their little tree farms there, might just dream of someday going to the big city, you know? They've heard the tales.
I'm the same girl who feels sorry for all the trees that are cut, that go into the Christmas tree lots that don't get purchased. And they know they grew up on a Christmas tree farm. So that's their thing. That someday they're going to get to be a Christmas tree in someone's home with a family, and then nobody buys them. And so they just get chopped up.
So you say they're just sitting around pining for the farm?
Perhaps. You did hear what happened to a particular... I'm not going to say news. The particular station, propaganda station, their tree got set on fire.
It was framed by... Okay, it was Fox News.
You had to phone.
Fox News building Christmas tree was set on fire. Their response to it was, it was a war on Christmas. Obviously, liberals did this. It actually was a homeless dude who was bored, and didn't even know it was Fox.
So
that narrative kind of fizzled out. But yeah, it definitely is a war on Christmas.
Isn't it? Every day. Every day.
You walk through Times Square and you just see the war. You see the war. Christmas won. I think the war is over. Christmas has prevailed.
And yay!
Every storefront and... it's lovely. I mean, you know, I am not a religious person, but I enjoy Christmas. I enjoy the heck out of Christmas and always have. You know, I enjoy the Santa Claus. I enjoy the Rudolph. There's plenty of stuff, you know, and plus, you know, the pagan tree stuff. And there's plenty of stuff for everybody to enjoy with Christmas, I think.
Yes.
Then
it's not Christmas. Then it is the holiday season, because Christmas is... No.
No?
Christmas is about the birth of Jesus Christ. So the holiday season, one would say, who isn't necessarily Christian.
Yeah, but you have to say Christmas, or otherwise people don't know what you're talking about. The secular part of Christmas is, I mean, whether you like it or not...
Who wouldn't know?
Has taken over. Right? I mean,
who wouldn't know?
No?
Who wouldn't? I can't come up with anyone who wouldn't know. You know?
Who would know?
Who wouldn't know that Christmas?
Who wouldn't know of Christmas?
The purpose of Christmas, the story of Christmas. And if you don't believe it, that's all good. That's all fine. Everybody do you. But there is... Normally, people are nicer. There are other things that come with the season that are fun. I think it is. I think it's for everybody, regardless of your beliefs. Everybody take what you want from it. Take what you can. What makes you happy? What makes you celebratory? And that's yours.
Well, with the exception of the people who celebrate other people who belong to other religions and celebrate non-Christmas.
Yes, but I'm just saying, if you like the decoration.
Yeah,
what's
not to like? I love tinsel.
If you like all of that, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
If you find anything in this time that makes you happy, that brings you joy, take that. It's yours. Nobody's Christmas is the same, nor should it have to be. Their concept of it, their holiday, what they get from it, what they bring to it, do it your own way, man. Just do it with kindness. That's what I'm saying. As I just giggled about the phone news tree. I don't think I giggled.
Well, it's pretty funny. It would be funnier if it really was a war, if somebody actually did intentionally do that. It's like, even if they did, so what? It's destruction of property and nothing. They're just trying so hard to manufacture an outrage.
Yeah.
That it's kind of cute.
Which is why I am very glad that it wasn't something anywhere along the lines of what they were wanting it to be, because it took that away from them. And they just look foolish. Again.
Well, they look foolish to the people to whom they already looked foolish. I don't think the meatheads who watch them are going to remember. I mean, their memory's kind of reset. every news cycle.
They probably didn't even actually tell the truth about what happened.
That's possible.
I left that avid fan.
That's possible. They're not covering the January 6th commission in exactly the same way that other news outlets are.
That actual news outlets are?
They're kind of ignoring the whole thing, right? They're not even...
I do know that, of course, none of the text messages have been read, covered, anything like that.
And there was a PowerPoint presentation, not to be too alliterative.
Oh, and that's a to-do.
Yes. You have to marvel at the... not even just this, the audacity. Basically, they had the balls to lay out the whole plan in a PowerPoint, which is, you know, in and of itself is... But they were so bad at it, right? I mean, it's so like eighth grade...
It wasn't well done.
Kid who didn't do the project until the very last minute and then just like stayed up long enough to just barely get enough of it done. And it doesn't look good, but it's like, okay, well, here, I'll get the grade on it at least. Did not look good.
No.
And the last page was even the end. Yeah, the end.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, so I don't see anything happening, but at least now we know. And then that was a few days ago, I think, that came out. And then today, or a couple of days ago, the texts, Liz Cheney
read
some of the texts, right.
She read some while they were in the hearing itself, kind of making decisions on certain things. And then she read some again when they were preparing to vote. Segue in a way, but still to political corruption. So there's a representative from the fine state of Nebraska who has been charged with accepting illegal campaign contributions.
Uh-oh.
Well, and actually lying to the FBI.
Okay.
Three charges, I believe, three federal charges. Now, he's trying to fight it in the media, so he just, you know, and all the poor me, and they have his wife putting pleas out and how he's a victim of the left radicalism, the whole usual stuff. But now, here's where it even gets more entertaining. The guy has been in office for 16 years. So not only has he been making the $187.50 for 16 years, that doesn't count, you know, any of the freebies that he's gotten and how much he has made from lobbyists. Mm-hmm. His wife is putting out this plea, and it's been mentioned over and over, raising funds for his defense. Uh-huh. Because they can't afford it, I'm sure. That's where's the audacity. And that there's probably some fool somewhere who's saying, oh, that poor guy. Yeah, he is, man. He's just a victim. He's just a victim. No, it isn't.
Did they have a GoFundMe going?
There's some, they're raising funds somehow through some means. And he wants it in, it happened in Los Angeles. And so that's where they're going to go to court. And he thinks that it should be moved, that it doesn't have anything to do with Los Angeles. And in my mind, you know how they always complain about outside sources for money in campaigns and such?
Mm-hmm.
What's the guy who represents Eastern Nebraska doing having fundraisers in Los Angeles?
He's a Rams fan?
No. No. And they had another one. They were planning another one. So I said to myself, self, there's something stinky about this.
What's this dude's name?
Fortenberry.
Hmm.
And now he has also voted no to everything regarding January 6th. Okay. Don't hold anybody responsible. Don't do this. Don't do that. Blah, blah, blah. Now, last name Fortenberry. If you turn that O into an A, which you know happened to him all the time as a child, you get what name?
I think everybody can do the math on that one, right?
Fortenberry. Yeah. So he had some of those great big signs.
Uh-huh.
And nobody has really run against him for a long time, so it's not like he's that fantastic. Nobody just runs because he's a Republican and this is where we are. But things are turning around. So somebody, some people from Betsy Riot put googly eyes on some of the big signs and changed the O into an A. Pretty great, pretty funny. Have a sense of humor, right? Nope. Find out who they are. Find out who they are. Press charges.
Well, what charges would there be? Is that really vandalism?
Destruction of property, vandalism. Yeah. All those big ones.
Which is a misdemeanor, isn't it?
All those big ones.
Yeah.
So it spent who knows how much of the state's money chasing that down. And then decided not to press charges. I think, I don't know necessarily why they didn't follow through with it as far as taking it to court. I think maybe somebody, hopefully, got to him and said, you realize how ridiculous this is going to be, right? That you will not look like the victor over this. But still, how much of the state's money got wasted? And now, these poor patriots from January 6th, they weren't doing anything. But somebody who turned the O to an A, better get him. So it's just goofiness.
Business as usual for those people. Did you mention he's a Republican? You did, Brian?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Don't even have to.
No.
At this point.
But I think there are only about two actual Republicans left. And I can't say I agree with the way they vote most of the time, but at least they are displaying some integrity when it matters. So go Adam Kinzinger and Liz Cheney. Again, I don't agree with the way you vote most of the time. But at least, by gosh, the chips are down and you're standing up for something.
Yeah, I would certainly give them that they're the best of that bunch. Yep.
The others are not Republicans anymore because they have no values, there's nothing.
It's the Trump Party.
Mm-hmm. Trump Republicans.
Yeah, that's, yeah. I think they would be proud to say that, most of them.
Probably.
Not all of them would say it publicly, but...
No. I would like to hear from Mitt Romney, who in past times at least stood up with a little moral fortitude, that he's even gone radio silent. It's all unfortunate.
Is he, like, just hoping that Trump dies so that he could have a shot at the nomination?
I don't know. I don't know how much his people have fallen down the rabbit hole. No, it's not a rabbit hole. Rabbits are cute. Down the stinkhole.
Yeah.
And the whole idea, again, that's supposed to be a job for a while. Get in there, do what you can do that's good. And then go do something else. And now everything is, oh, I want to be reelected. I want to be reelected for what? Not supposed to be a lifetime career. Although some of the people who were there, I actually like, and I'm kind of glad some of them have, but as a general rule, some of them can go home. Some of them can go home. They've lost their moral compass. And that's an important thing, I think. Do you remember when we were growing up and some of the people in government, you could be taught that these leaders were people that you would want to that kind of emulate. And now that's the farthest thing from my mind. If my son said, yeah, can I be like, I named off the vast majority of people. Like, no. No.
There are some exceptions. Very, very few exceptions. But yes, I agree.
No.
I would say Bernie Sanders is somebody that I certainly look up to and would like to be like. No,
well, I said that.
Been the real deal the whole time. Right, no, of course. I'm basically, it's there are so few that I could probably name them all right now.
Alphabetically, even.
Yeah, yeah. There aren't too many, so they stick out like a sore thumb.
And I'm horrified that Paul Gosar, whose five siblings have said even before the last campaign, he should not be allowed to even run.
Right.
He's so unstable, and he put out that anime video, and we don't even need to go into details of what's on there.
Right.
And people were like, no, that's fine. He was just joking. And everybody in the world was saying, if I did that in my place of business, I would be out in a heartbeat. Without hesitation, there would be no, please come to HR for a conversation. They would just be gone.
Correct. Any job. Any job.
Yeah.
The people who knew him the best, his family, pleaded with voters not to vote for him, right?
Like, yeah, that's what I'm saying.
They all got together and said, please, please, you don't know how bad he is. Don't vote for him. The people who knew him best did that.
Take him off the ballot. Don't even let him run. He is not stable, which obviously he is not.
He might be one of, you know, in the text thing, we're talking about the releasing of the texts on from January 6th. They named, they mentioned an unnamed congressman who texted something like, I'm sorry it didn't work.
Yeah, I'm sorry we couldn't get it done.
Right. Sorry we couldn't get it done. And, you know, there's so Adam Schiff said, we can't say the name because it's part of an ongoing investigation. But speculation is it could be him.
That almost sounds too much of a together thought for him. But like, it's it. I only know that they said congressperson.
Oh, they did. Oh, I thought they said congressman. Okay, I stand for
okay.
It.
No, I could be wrong.
I thought that we'd eliminated the women because they said congressman, but I could be wrong.
No, I'm saying I could be wrong. Holy, look at this.
We could both be wrong, Mary. No, wait, we couldn't both be
wrong. Well, actually, yes, in this day and age, we could be.
Yeah. Well, as long as we still both hold our ground, then we're both right.
Because it makes you wonder, you know that Boebert and Green, Jim Jordan.
Right. Oh, it could be him. He's one of the suspects, too.
Who I'm horrified that he is still in there.
Mm-hmm.
After the Ohio State, somebody, please do something about this. I think we need to contact the Jim, now that the settlement has come with, I'm not even going to say doctor in front of his name anymore, we'll call him Larry Nassar. You heard about that settlement?
No, what was the settlement?
25 million.
Wow.
I could be wrong on that one also. Goodness gracious, I'm just wrong a lot, but I believe that's what it is. And so I would hope that some of them would make their mission now to champion for other people who have been in that situation and are not getting the attention to receive the justice that they should.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, imagine the influence that these gymnasts had in that arena. I don't think a whole lot of people would be able to ignore them any longer.
No. So he's on the hook for $25 million? That's the deal? Does he have that kind of money?
Imagine not.
Mm-hmm. So it's sort of it's a symbolic victory, but...
I don't know necessarily.
Uh-huh.
Anything that I were to say at this point would be purely speculation. And I've already been wrong enough today.
We like speculation.
I just want things to be fair, kind, and good. I'm tired of icky.
Choose one.
Which one?
Well, you can't have all three.
I can.
That's real pie in the sky type of thing.
I recently learned about the two different types of meditation.
Okay.
I don't know. Do you meditate?
I don't. I've always, to be honest, I've always been intrigued, and I'm interested in it, but I never have tried it. Now, so there's, you're talking like transcendental?
No.
The other type? No. Okay.
Focused and diffuse.
Okay.
Focused is kind of obvious, and that there are certain times for each, and I find it hard to shut my brain down just to kind of go into the diffuse where you just let your mind roam and go wherever. But our minds need breaks. And so kind of learning, and that again, there are certain times that focused where you are focusing on a particular thing, focusing in a certain area of what you're working on. Holy Bucks is just a simple, there's a MOOC that I'm taking, although I'm not even sure what MOOC is, MOOC.
Well, you call them a MOOC.
That's what they're called.
Okay.
I'm taking a few for fun and to learn. And it's really good. If you go through Coursera, I took a human trafficking course through there years and years ago when they first started.
Mm-hmm.
And you get teachers from all over. I took one with an instructor from Yale. Mm-hmm. There's Edinburgh University from all over. You can take one class at a time. You can take as many as you want. You can just sign up and pay for one. Or you can get on this little plan where for this really reasonable fee, you can take as many classes as you want. And it's just a monthly charge. And I'm becoming much more enlightened, much more zen from all the stuff I'm taking.
That's very cool.
Much happier, yeah.
So now, what is transcendental meditation? It's a whole different thing?
I didn't study that.
Okay. No, I'm just, do you know what the difference is? I mean, because to me...
You transcend. I would think that would fall under, that would fall in diffuse.
Okay. To me, it seems like a bit of a cult, but I don't know that I have hard evidence that it is.
How could it be a cult? Because you do it individually.
Well, but there's a bunch of money. There's people who are making a lot of money on it, aren't there? Isn't there like a TM center? And you can buy books and buy online, you know, classes and stuff like that. I mean, there's money changing hands.
Yeah, there's a center for everything.
Okay.
Isn't there?
I know there's a center of a Tootsie Roll Pop, but I don't know how many licks it takes to get to that center.
The owl would tell you three.
It would be three, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I'm going to go with the owl. Who am I to...
Oh, who are you?
Never mind.
Who are you? You're just all over this kind of stuff today. Mm. Man. No, but the hearings are exciting. Mark Meadows now contempt. Steve Bannon, who's just a yucky, yucky individual, in my view. Oh, and Madison Cawthorn, please.
Mm-hmm. That's the eye patch guy, right?
No.
That's the wheelchair guy, sorry.
Yeah. Ted Cruz. Go back to Cancun. I don't think they wanted him there either. God, who else? And Nunes left to go run Donald's media empire.
Because his district has been... redistrict, right? So he's basically guaranteed to lose there. So he's like, yeah, I'm just going to leave.
I don't know.
I think that's what happened. Yeah. He was, it was one of those things. They changed the size of the district and that.
He got gerrymandered out?
Yeah, I guess it's gerrymandered. Yeah. Yeah, I guess so.
Go Democrats. You finally got to gerrymander something.
Yeah. Yeah. One, it's like taking a pawn. Getting slaughtered in a chess game, but then finally taken a pawn.
Yeah, that's wicked day here today.
Yeah, well, that's crazy. When did this whole thing start? It's been the whole day, right? Like early in the afternoon.
Yes, because it kind of changed my plans for the day. I was going to dash home and do a bunch of stuff. My dentist's office even called to see just for cleaning. If I still wanted to come in, because they had quite a few people calling and canceling, or allow me to say rescheduling.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that was pretty nice. And I thought, yeah, given the option, I'll reschedule.
Sure. So this isn't related to the Kentucky tornadoes, right? I mean, is it out of the same storm front or?
No idea.
Totally different.
No idea.
Both of them are pretty odd to be happening in the middle of December.
Yes. Weather is not normal anymore. Lots of wind, and it's the car wash. I just call it car wash rain because that's what it's like. When it's the kind of rain that when you're driving with this, you can actually see clearer if you just shut your windshield wipers off.
Hmm. Oh, okay. Yeah. That's what car wash rain is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Where it's a sheet of water that goes just... a continuous sheet, so as opposed to turning on your wipers and having that blur that goes sometimes,
mm-hmm.
it's like glass.
It's like a car wash, but without the big soapy brushes.
Yeah.
Right through.
Mm-hmm.
Which is the fun part.
Yeah, except my puppy. Well, he's getting used to them. He didn't like them at first, and so he felt bad when we would go through them.
Well, maybe you should let him ride on the inside of the car.
Of course wah, I wah, do. Wah, wah.
Just a little joke, buddy. Now, see, I would probably have a dog. I live with a dog, you know, if I did not live in the city, because I really feel strongly against having a dog, even a little dog, in an apartment. It's just, it's not enough space for them. Cats are different, but see, I don't like, I'm sorry.
You don't prefer cats.
I love all God's creatures, don't get me wrong, except for cockroaches, snakes, rats.
Spiders.
Noah loves spiders. Bed bugs.
Yeah.
Love spiders.
Hate spiders.
So I guess that's just where I draw the line right there. On the bug side, oh, mosquitoes. So on the bug side, mosquitoes, cockroaches, and bed bugs. And that's probably it. And then all snakes, just every single snake that's ever lived or ever will live.
And that is all very Freudian, but if somebody told me I could choose between having a spider or a snake, I'd be, send a snake on over.
Well, Dr. Freud, I don't know what you're getting at there, but yes. I like a big, hairy spider every now and then.
Just don't get gross.
Big
tarantula. But it's a friend of mine, and I think I had told you this story. I'd come back to town one time visiting, she'd moved out to Colorado, and she had snakes. And we happened to have been out imbibing, as people do.
Mm.
And I don't even remember where she got her hands on the newspaper, because this was before all of the internet. I will sell you this, that, and the other thing. And there was an ad for a 4-foot Burmese python. So we went and looked at it. And she got it. I just put my little Cocker Spaniel, who was adorable, in my room for a little while. So we took it out of the aquarium. And I hadn't been a snake fan, but this snake was so cool. And I held it, and it had no intention of trying to squeeze me. It wasn't that big, and it had been fed.
Mm-hmm.
And that evening, I really developed an appreciation for snakes.
But now, what if it hadn't been fed? Would you have had the same appreciation for it while you were being slowly squozed to death?
I don't think we would have been holding it.
Uh-huh.
Or she would have made sure to get it some nourishment before we picked it up. She was very responsible. It was, again, not her first snake.
Mm-hmm.
My son and I we used to go to movies quite often. And, you know, life does what it does, and everyone gets quite busy. You have kids, you know how that goes. So a week or two ago, we made the commitment that we were going to go to a matinee yesterday. Tuesday's a special movie day. It's $5, and they have treat specials and all kinds of fun things. And we went to the new Ghostbusters movie.
Uh-huh.
And really enjoyed it. It was fun. They did a good job with it. They put an actual story in it. And they were very respectful to Harold with that whole situation. And so it was nice. It was fun. It was one of those where they didn't try and create some whole other bizarre thing that you have to go, what? You were able to go with it. That, and one thing I will say is one of the actors from Stranger Things is in there.
Oh, yeah, one of the kids, Finn Wolfhard, I think is his name, right? Finn
I'm
Wolfhard.
Not gonna tell you, you just have to go watch it and see for yourself.
No, I've seen the trailer. He's in the trailer.
Well, then, okay, yeah.
Yeah, he's one of the stars. I mean, that's, geez, am I not allowed to know anything about the movie?
Oh, yeah, but you said who? I think that was a little snarky, don't you think?
A bit.
A lot? No, I just wasn't going to say anything. that people wanted to go. And then it was like, oh my gosh, that's who she was talking about. Like that. Yeah, it is. It's cute. And not just cute. I mean, it was well done. It was worth the time.
Mm-hmm.
Then I got to go to a movie with my son, which is always good. And I am loving these allergies, man.
Were there people at the theater coming back to the movies yet?
There were quite a few cars out there. Again, this was a weekday afternoon. An old Bob's friend of mine was there with her grandson. They were going to the same movie. And, you know, people wearing masks, so I hadn't really looked over and said something about, I heard them saying something about Ghostbusters. And I said, my son and I are also going to that movie. We used to go to matinees all the time, blah, blah, blah. And then all of a sudden, Mary? Oh my gosh, I knew I recognized your voice. And she and I hadn't even seen each other, spoken to each other in, gosh, a few years. So that was nice to get to have a quick conversation.
Hmm.
No, there were not a whole lot of people in that theater, but there were quite a few cars out in the lot, and families going, Encanto was also at that, is also at that theater.
Okay.
So there were parents taking their littles to that movie.
Is there a mask mandate or anything? Do you need?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Which is what? You have to wear a mask, or do you have to show proof of vaccination or anything like
that? Indoor mask mandate.
Okay. But no, you don't have to show proof of vaccination, right?
No.
Okay.
And there are so many pouty children in this town that it's silly. Just silly, silly, silly. Like, what's the big deal? You know, and especially then if you go to a theater and you're sitting down, there weren't a lot of people around us and we had snacks. So, of course, we took our masks off.
Mm-hmm.
At a restaurant, you take the mask off while you're dining. No, I don't understand all the immaturity. I just don't.
In New York City has just changed. They've amended it. For kids, because now kids can be vaccinated here.
Mm-hmm.
So for movie theaters to be admitted to a movie theater, it was that you had to show proof of vaccination and an ID, right? It was for anybody 12 and over. And now it's anyone from 5 to 12 has to have at least one shot. And then that's effective now. And then I think in 2 weeks, they will have to have both shots or something like that, or 3 weeks. Something like that.
I've been following that a bit because it's interesting. It'll be easier to get that done in New York than most places in the United States, but I'm interested to see how the people respond once it's really in effect.
Mm-hmm. You know, I manage a theater. It's an indie theater. It's not one of the big Regal theaters or AMC or any of those smaller scale. And we generally don't show the big studio things. But our customer base, our customers have been like almost 100% compliant. We've never had a real wacko. We've had a couple of people I shouldn't say that. We've had a couple of wackos, but they never did anything. They never like refused to leave or anything like that. They were just, oh, that's a bunch of shit when asked to show people backstage. Yeah, but that's as far as it's ever gotten.
That's nice.
Yeah, yeah. I can't speak to what, you know, the big mall theaters. Well, there aren't really malls here, but like the big stadium seat theaters, you know, where they've got thousands of people coming through in a day. I don't know. And they have just kids working there. I don't know.
Conestoga, where you are?
Well, that's AMC. That was an AMC theater. That was the first theater that I worked in. First job I had, I should say. I didn't have a life of working in theaters or anything. I happened to work in a theater then, and I happen to work in a theater now. But, that was an AMC theater, and they have AMC theaters here. There's a big one in Times Square. It's like 45 theaters, I think. AMC 45 or something. Wait.
My goodness.
The street it's on. it's a lot. It could be 30 some theaters. I don't know, but there's a lot of theaters there. It's like five or six floors, yeah. megaplex.
That might be too many theaters.
Well, it's, you get...
For me.
You get your choice of movies, I mean, is the idea. I think there's,
yeah,
there's more screens to fill.
That's just a lot of people. It's a lot of people.
Well, you know what, Mary? New York is full of people. We got
it.
Yeah, yeah. People everywhere. Everywhere you go.
Yeah. Why I like our seats in the football stadium. There's 90,000+ people that you might get in there, but it's organized chaos because you go to a seat. And while I realize that movie theaters anymore, when you purchase your ticket, you select your seat.
Not at our theater, but yeah, a lot of them. Yeah.
It's just a whole lot of people wandering around that can bump into you, and that's just a lot of people.
Mm. Well, yeah, I don't think... Here's the thing. Spider-Man is opening... Actually, tomorrow. And so that's, they're treating that like the big movie to try to get people back into theaters, you know,
mm-hmm.
because people just aren't, you know, even, there's been some success with a couple of movies, but for the most part, you know, people aren't coming back the way they used to be. We lost a musical giant this week, talking about Mike Nesmith of the Monkees, the one with the cap. So we're down to one monkey. We're down to Mickey, and that's it. And then there was one. Yes, so Mike Nesmith was 78, and he had had a heart, like a pretty major heart surgery, maybe a year or so ago. And yeah. But he and Mickey did a little, like a, they called it the Monkees Farewell Tour, which I think is a little, it would be like Paul and Ringo calling it a Beatles farewell tour. But be that as it may, maybe they had no decision in that, but it was Mike and Mickey did a tour, and and it ended just like a month before he died.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, it really, really was a farewell tour.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. But yeah, he was, you know, for the longest time, I don't know if it, you probably remember, like in the 80s, the mid 80s, when MTV was, you know, was happening, and there was sort of a comeback. They started showing the Monkees show, the TV show, on MTV.
Love and that show.
Fantastic show, and it, so it became like suddenly the Monkees were in demand again, and they went out on a tour, but Mike wanted no part of that. So it was the three other. It was Davey, Mickey, and Peter, who went on a tour, and they came to, I don't know if you remember this, but they came to our hometown, Grand Island, Nebraska, to the Hall County Fair. Mm-hmm.
No way.
They performed there. Well, so I guess I take it you weren't there that night. I was there that night and saw them. Yeah, it was Mickey and Davey and Peter. They didn't play instruments. They basically shared the front of the stage, and it was like a song and dance.
What year?
What year would that have been? 80, let me think. I left in 84, so I think it was right before, it was probably 83. I'm guessing, like, summer of 83 would be my guess. You can look it up.
Oh, that was already those years. I basically actually only went back for Christmas and Thanksgiving.
Okay, not the Monkees.
Well, I wouldn't have known because I wasn't going to the fair and wasn't. I mean, in all honesty, the only thing I paid attention to was what was going on with the arena in which my father was involved, mm-hmm. and just families that were friends of our families. I wasn't really keeping track of people I had been friends with at school or anything that was happening in the town. I kind of had decided to move on.
Mm-hmm. Well, I moved on in 84. I hung around probably longer than I should have, but... Yeah.
But, you know, out of your system.
Yeah. Yeah. I think had I stayed there any longer, I would have stayed there. So, yeah.
You know, I have some friends who reside there now.
Mm-hmm.
And it works for them.
Sure.
I don't think it would work for me. And that's not saying anything about the town by any means. Bloom where you planted, man. But I don't think that would have been a good place for me to be planted there. I'll say it that way. Because that's nothing. I mean, I know some people who are very happy there.
Yeah, you know, it's everybody's different. Everybody wants different things and needs different things. And I mean, I wouldn't recommend living in New York City for everybody.
No.
But I cannot, at this point, really see not living here. It's so ingrained in me that I just take it for granted. City life is just...
It suits you.
Yeah, exactly. But I don't begrudge anybody who doesn't move out of their hometown. No. I mean, I think I begrudge the people who stay in their hometown and think they know anything about the world. Those people I don't like. It's like, travel at least a little bit. You know, see some other... See how the other 99% lives, you know, before you have any opinions on things.
Yes. There are lots of places I need to go.
Yeah, well, I can't say I'm well-traveled. I mean, I'm...
No, I'm not speaking for you. I'm just saying I, me, mm-hmm. me, need to go see my friend Jody in London. Need to go to the Australian Zoo just because I need to go to the Australian Zoo.
Okay. Do they have kangaroos there? Probably not.
Yes.
No, they probably don't, right? It would be like having pigeons in the Bronx Zoo.
Yes, they do.
Really?
They do.
I'm going to challenge you.
I think I watched the show.
They have kangaroos. So what do they do? It's like, oh, this behold the majestic kangaroo that you see in your yard on a daily basis.
But they're not like a zoo, but it's not always people who live there who go to the zoo. It's tourists are huge.
Mm-hmm.
And then a lot of times injured animals that people have found, and they will nurse them back. And then sometimes the animal can go back into the wild, and sometimes they cannot. And so it's little ones who cannot go back, stay there. And then have to go get the compound going in Costa Rica. I got to get back in touch with Jen and Kim and Tom on that. We got to get to work on that.
What's the compound?
Oh, it doesn't have a name. I think we named it once, but I don't remember. We didn't want to feel like it had to have a name. You know, that's... I wish I could remember the whole concept. It's in my text. But naming it would have been expected, and, you know, that's just not us. No. You don't have to define or name things.
What do you call someone who feels that way?
That it doesn't have to be named?
Yeah, so what would you call somebody who feels the way that you feel about that, about not naming things?
Well, that's just our whole thing with our compound. Definitely. No, I don't name things. I guess a lot of times. I just, you know, go with the flow. You put names on things, you put titles, it comes with a definition and expectations, and then, you know.
Labels are for cans, man.
Mm-hmm. That's it, though.